It's me, Trinity K. Bonet, as you all know, and today I have the honor of interviewing somebody who's extremely important in my life, one of my all-time favorite entertainers in the industry, art form of female impersonation. She is the reigning Miss International Queen, and for those who do not know what that means she is like the creme de la creme of pageantry, in my opinion. She went to Thailand to conquer this title. She has been and will be so much, and I'm just so honored to sit here with you. Thank you for taking the time out to be here with me. I thought I knew what I wanted to say for my intro, but now that we're doing it, I'm kind of nervous. But nonetheless, you can explain you better than anybody else. So my first question to you would be is, who is Giselle Barbie Royale?
Okay. So Giselle Barbie Royale is an entertainer that was created in 2000 and probably 4 or 5. I created Giselle in like 2004, and I got the name Giselle from watching America's Next Top Model. There was a girl named Giselle on there. Mm-hmm. And so, I was like, okay, my name is going to be Giselle. And then I got my spelling from the show director in Jacksonville at the time was the lady Marissa. And she would write my name, Jazell, on the lineup. And mm-hmm. I just adopted that. And Barbie came from me sitting in the house, joking with my friends. I was getting ready for my very first pageant, which was Miss Duval Newcomer. And I was stone in my dress and everything, and I was just like rehearsing, seeing how I was gonna walk and act. And I told my friends, I said, I'm gonna say I'm Giselle Barbie Royale, and then we were just laughing at first. Mm-hmm. But then everybody was like, oh, that's cute. And so I said, I'm gonna put it for real. And then my last name Royale comes from my gay family, which is Native Bahamian. So,
oh really?
Yes, that's where that name comes from, Royale. We're, they're all Bahamian. Yeah.
So as well as Fanny, she is also
Fanny, Latrice, all of us.
Oh, beautiful. Yeah. Okay. Well, okay, so that's dope. See, now we know where Giselle Barbie Royale came from. So tell us, who is Giselle Harvey?
Okay, so Giselle Harvey is, well, someone that I've always been. I just didn't have the knowledge or the lingo or education to express it as a young age. But when I turned 16, I had the answers to how I had been feeling, and I had the resources to medicate. I did medicate myself, but Giselle is a transgender woman that made a decision to transition at a very early age, and I didn't turn back. I don't have any regrets from transitioning. Giselle is many things. Giselle is, I'm a mother, I'm a sister, I'm a daughter, I'm a counselor, I just, many things, you know. Giselle is many, many things, so, yeah, that's Giselle Harvey. She's a singer, she's all kind of things.
So, as far as your transitioning starting at 16, tell us how that transpired as far as family is concerned, because mm-hmm. there are so many people who are transitioning and, of course, you know, being told or put out by their parents and family that, you know, who they decide or who they feel like they are isn't, mm-hmm. you know, right. For you, was it the same situation? And if not, tell us, you know, how that happened.
Honestly, for me, once I surrounded myself around my friends that I could relate to, or we call them our gay family, once I got around them and I got the knowledge that I needed and the understanding as to what hormones were going to do to me, what my life was going to be like, once I gained that knowledge, that's when I gained the courage to tell my mom that I was transitioning. So I had two coming outs. I had to do the first initial coming out as gay. That was what I thought I was supposed to do, but that's not really what it was. And then when I got the words for it, and when I got the education, I was able to say, "Mom, look, this is what it is." Mm. And I had her support. And honestly, when I went into it, I had the mindset, basically, she's the only person who I'm seeking their support. My mom was the only person that I cared about supporting me. I had already said in my mind, if nobody else wants to support me and accept me, I don't care. I just want my mom to support me. And once I had that support from her, it was smooth sailing from there, and everybody else just pretty much fell in.
So do you think the respect value of you came from your mother being a very strong focal point in your family, and family just kind of gravitating towards her? Or do you think your family just genuinely have a love and respect for you?
Oh, my family loves me.
Okay.
My family, they love me. But just in case somebody felt different, I had it planted in my mind that I only was looking for her validation and her acceptance.
Yeah.
But my family,
brothers, mothers, everybody.
Yes, I'm the oldest, so they don't have a choice. My siblings don't have a choice. They don't have a choice if they were going to accept it or like it, because I'm the oldest. I'm on both sides, mom and dad side. I'm the oldest, so I'm over them. They're not over me.
So, what was life for Giselle at this point, growing up, teen and trans? Like, did you still attend school? Mm-hmm. Were you, cause you know, like when you transition naturally in that lifestyle, mm-hmm. your gay family is there to bring you in, but they also kind of expose you to other things in the lifestyle. Mm-hmm. You know, you kind of grew up a little bit faster mm-hmm. than most people. So were you daylife and nightlife, or were you just kind of like nightlife and then just like, how did that work?
So life for me being a teenage transgender girl, it was very interesting. I went anywhere I wanted to go, in the malls. I went everywhere because I felt like myself, and I never felt like an outcast, but I was introduced to a lot of different things as a 16-year-old. I was introduced to the streets by friends, you know, and innocently, because I can't say that I was someone that went without, or I was ever homeless. I was never homeless. I was never without, never. But when you're introduced to things, like there was, at 16 years old, I couldn't go to my mom and ask her for makeup or a purse or a dress.
Yeah.
I couldn't do that at that time. So older friends of mine introduced me to working the stroll, you know, working the streets. And so
they're not giving it to you. You have to go work for what you want.
Yeah, and so when I had my first experience, it was like I got a rush. I didn't have to do much, you know, and fortunately enough, the girls at that time, they really did teach us, you know, teach us how to protect ourselves. So we weren't out there being reckless, you know. And my first experience, I just had a rush because I'm 16 years old, and then, you know, I went from not having anything in my pocket to somebody giving me $80. It was like, whoa.
In less than 5 minutes.
Yeah, it was like, whoa. And so I was then able to create Giselle that way. I was able to go and buy, you know, the wigs and the hair and the hormones, and I was able to support myself without having to ask anyone for it. And I was still in school. I was still in high school. And so my experience with that, I would dress as a male going to school, but I was on hormones and stuff. But then over the summer, things really began to change, and I really started to look really feminine, and I couldn't hide things anymore. And when I tried to go back to school, they were not.
They weren't buying it.
They were not with it. Like, it was like, they just were not. And it's something it'll always stick with me. You know, them not allowing me to go back to school because they could see the changes in me. And it wasn't that I looked bad. It was just, okay, you done went to school here all these years, and now you want to come to let your senior year. And so I rebelled and I dropped out, and I just, you know, and the rest is history pretty much. I did go on later to, you know, further my education and stuff, but yeah, that was my
I'm sure that teenage. was a tough situation.
It was very tough.
I'm sure, like, you were one of those, you know, people who may have been gay and trans, but was engaged in school and education, and like those things were important to you.
Yeah.
So to not be able to.
Yeah, graduating from school was important to me. Still to this day, when I go to graduations, all my siblings graduated from high school. When I go to graduations to this day, whether college, high school, I get emotional because I didn't have that moment.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, me I didn't have that moment. And every time I see it, I'm like, I do get emotional. And it wasn't all about academics. I discovered who I was in high school, and that was more important to me than anything. It was more important to me than school. It was more important to me than anything. And, you know, I wanted to finish, but they just weren't. Going to a black high school, and you got all these women guidance counselors and this and that and all of that, and they all church ladies, and this, they weren't even trying to understand it. And I had a best friend of mine that actually went to another high school in Jacksonville, but she went to like a it was like a magnet school or something like that. Mm-hmm. But she was actually, her advantage, she was able to go to school as herself, as a trans female. But she had the protection of the state because she was a child of the state. Mm-hmm. So they're not gonna mess with that, you know, when you're basically like an orphan. Mm-hmm. And so they didn't bother her. They knew that, okay, this is a child of the state, we're not gonna bother that, and they allowed her to go to school. I actually went to the prom with her. That was as a teenager too. That was something that was very liberating for she and I. She asked me to go to the prom with her. And here we were, two teenage trans girls going to the prom. I will never forget that. And it felt so good to be able, it wasn't my prom, but it felt so good to be able to go to the prom. And the response we got was beautiful. It honestly was. I can never forget it. Like, I thought that people were going to be like, oh my gosh, da, da, da. I mean, all the guys, they were taking pictures with us, and like nobody said anything or did anything.
Thank you.
Giselle, Giselle has formed this identity mm-hmm. as a woman, and you are now part of a gay family mm-hmm. Under the direction of, at the time, I'm assuming, the Lady Marissa.
Yeah, well, my gay family is, oh my gosh. I mean, you're part of my gay family.
Like, at that present time, like at the beginning,
my examples, not even Marissa. Well, no, I take that back. Yes, it did start with Marissa, because when I, my first time stepping foot into a club, she was the first thing I saw. You know, I literally like just walked straight in and she.
Was this Metro?
This was at In Cahoots. It was 3D actually then. And when I walked in, she was doing a Alicia Keys song. And then Alexis came behind her. So I immediately identified with what they were doing. Immediately. It was because I had been doing it.
At the house.
At the house.
Yeah.
Since I was a little kid. In front of my mom. In front of my grandmother. Like, my grandmother, she was one of the vain people that... She's the reason why I know every word that I'm Every Woman and all these songs. My grandmother was the one. We used to ride around and sing those songs.
Was it? Because I know for me, drag is my drug of choice. Mm-hmm. Like it's my high.
Yeah,
Red Bull. yeah, very good. But you know, drag is honestly like my drug of choice. It's what it what gears me. It's what takes me out of my personal depression. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So for you, when you did your very first show in mm-hmm. in song, whatever that may have been. What did that feeling do for you, and then where did it take you from there? Like, so from the very first show, sum up everything from that on that.
My first show was at 3D, mm-hmm. 711 Edison Avenue, and it was on a Wednesday night, and it was the talent show, and I did In the Midst of It All by Yolanda Adams. Mm-hmm. And when I got out there, it was just like, I already knew what to do.
It was organic.
Yeah, it wasn't something that I had to learn, because I've always been on stage entertaining people. Before I ever knew that I knew, came to the terms or had the language to know that I was transgender, I have always been on stage singing and performing for people. So it was nothing new. It was just, the only difference was I wasn't using my actual God-given voice. I was able to pantomize and express myself in a different way. And I was able to, like you said, organically entertain them, because I actually know what it's like to sing. And when you know what it's like to sing and you know how to sing, then you know how to really express yourself when you're singing to someone else's voice.
Yeah, I do not know how to sing.
Well, you did do a good job. But when you are a singer, it you're really able to, you know how to use your mouth. And when
you have that love for music.
Yeah.
That love for good quality music.
And you're able to do.
Yeah.
Emote.
Yeah. So from there, then you did your shows, and then who introduced the idea of pageantry?
Okay, so pageants. That's a good question. I never thought about, like, exactly my first time like seeing a pageant. I don't even remember. I think, okay. My first time being in the pageant environment, or what people talking about pageants. Oh my goodness. For what I can remember is the year that Antoinette was giving up Miss Duval, and that was the year that Aja won Miss Duval. That was like my first time, like, okay, everybody's like, oh, you're gonna do Duval. I'm like, I'm young. I'm like, okay. And they introduced me to certain people, and it was just like big deal. And I went. And I went, and I remember when I walked in, I remember one of the formers walking down for the former walk, and they had just lost their minds. And I was glued from there. But how I really got my love for pageantry, after watching a pageant, I had a neighbor, where she a queen that stayed like on the next street, that had a library of pageants. Champagne Shantae, she lives in Jacksonville. She had a library of VHS tapes, and she would allow me to come over every single day. And I kid you not, exaggerate not, I would go to her house every single day, and I would stay there for the entire day. Like, I sometimes probably wouldn't eat or drink or anything.
Because you was watching.
I would sit at that house, and I would watch pageant after pageant after pageant after pageant. And it wasn't until I had my favorites, because there were certain people that were always in pageants. Like Aja, every time I would pop in a tape, she was in the pageant. And most times, she won.
And you grew that fan.
I like to see people who are going to win. First of all, I loved her beauty, but I also was captured by the way she always ended up winning, pretty much. And she was always on point. But it wasn't until I saw Paris, France. When I saw her, I saw me. And when I say I saw me, not saying that I felt like I looked like her or we resembled.
She was my color.
You know, yeah. She was my color. She was, in my head, I was like, okay, this is what I want to do. And if I'm going to do it, this is what I want to look like. You know, and that, so as soon as I saw her, I was like, that's it. And so she was my inspiration as far as like being able to identify and know that's what it is, right? Yep, that's it. That's how I want it, yep.
Oh God, mine would have been, well, my first pageant was Continental 98, and then for me, that person was Jasmine.
On tape, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
On tape, and then for me it was Jasmine Bonet, and
yes,
it was just,
yes,
I couldn't, I was like, God, she is beautiful. Yeah. And her choice of fashions, mm-hmm. and then I started seeing her on more tapes, same way, you know, mm-hmm. watching tapes, Dumar, blase blase, and it was just like, Jesus. And I wanted that last name. Mm-hmm. I wanted that last name, and I couldn't, nobody in Miami had that last name.
Mm-hmm.
And Natasha Braxton became my gay mother.
I didn't know that.
She was my very first gay mother.
I didn't know that. Natasha is like a godmother to me. Yeah,
sis.
Yeah.
But yeah, and then Kendall became my father, and sadly to say, only because his last name was Bonet, and I wanted it. I'm so sorry, Daddy. I know you're right. But I swear, at the time, that was the case. His last name was Bonet, and I wanted that last name. And of course, I love him dearly now. He's like my mm-hmm. biological father in a sense, but I wanted the name because I wanted to make her proud.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, hopefully I've done that. But I get where, you know, that whole connection with an entertainer off of those tapes come from, because that definitely was mine.
Yeah.
So from there, you got introduced to pageantry, and then you started competing, mm-hmm. and you did a bunch of shit. You know, just to name a few, Duval won that, mm-hmm. Tampa Bay probably won that.
No, actually, I beat me
at Black America Newcomer.
I was first alternate at Tampa Bay Newcomer and regular Miss Tampa Bay.
I was there when you got first at regular Tampa Bay. I was there.
We had to do Q&A twice.
Yeah, I was there. No. But no,
shout out to my sister Kyla. She'll be here tonight.
Yeah. But let's just run through all of the stuff that you've conquered if we can. So we've been doing.
I started my very first pageant was Miss Duval Newcomer. Kyla won. I was first alternate, and then I went on to win Miss Look International Newcomer. I got ahead of myself. My very first pageant that I ever won was Tri County Newcomer. Very first pageant that I won. And I actually beat the same people that
I won that too.
I actually beat Kyla. So I got my revenge that night. And I remember my granddad, Rick Zinn, which has been a huge, huge, huge influence in my whole career. He said to me that night, he said, "She's better than you. And I think, she's going to win," or something like that. Something he said to that. And he said that to me, and I gave him this look.
That fire.
And I said, "No, she's not." I said, "No, she's not." I said, "Okay." And I walked off, and I don't know what else I did. I don't even remember what category we were on, but I know at the end of that night, they were putting that crown on my head, and I don't know if he did that or said that to put fire under me, but it worked. But Tri-County was the first pageant that I won, and then I won Look International, who was owned by the late, great Animosity from Albany, Georgia. I won't remember all of them. I won Black America Newcomer. Mm-hmm. I won, that's all really newcomers. I got first run up at a lot of new, I got first run up at
yeah, we were Sweetheart. First run up Boots.
Yeah, I got Sweetheart. I got first run up at a lot of those. And I never felt newcomer, but I wanted to be two newcomers in my book, because at that time, all the newcomer systems were based in Jacksonville at that time. Sweetheart, Black America, and Duval Newcomer were all, and Tri-County, mm-hmm. were all held at the Metro in Jacksonville. Mm-hmm. So it was right there in my face. So for me, personally, I wanted to be Miss Duval Newcomer, and I wanted to be Miss Sweetheart Newcomer. Those were the ones that I like, I want to be those two. Mm-hmm. But I ended up, winning Black America and winning Tri-County, Tri-County, was great. Sergio was great and everything. I had my, difficulties with Black America Newcomer, which I have no problem. If I can praise the system, I'll tell you if I didn't have the experience. Because, unfortunately, you're going to have some good experiences and some bad experiences when you compete or when you reign in pageants. What else? So after Black America, it stopped. Newcomer stopped. Oh, and I won Texas America. That's when things skyrocketed. I won Texas America Newcomer in Houston, Texas. It was my first time ever getting on the airplane, everything. I won that. I won every category. And the place was in an uproar, not because I won every category, it was because I won presentation. In presentation, my earring fell off, completely off. Mm-hmm. And then the girl that, that had the crowd that was from there, my sister Shayla Nicole, she came out there in the wedding gown with the bride, with the groom and everything. And Adam was the groom. He had on black socks. He was wrinkled,
it weren't right.
Yeah, so
it weren't right.
So my one little earring, Yeah, and so they were just in a uproar that I won presentation, and I remember them just. I know I'm babbling, but I remember them just being in an uproar, and so many of them was, they wanted to just jump on us. And those very same people that were in that uproar became, my friends and people that I'm still friends with to this day. Chelsea and so many of them.
I love my Houston family. Yeah. Shout out to Houston.
Yes, I love Houston.
So from newcomer, we became Duval.
So my first step up was a Black Universe prelim. I won that. Then, oh my gosh, I couldn't dare go through all of the one.
Oh, I could say Duval, Dumar.
That I won?
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Duval, Dumar, Wesley. We may not be in no particular order.
Yeah.
Miss Florida.
Mm-hmm. What year?
We're gonna get to that a little later. of course, Miss Continental.
Uh-huh.
Jesus Christ. What else have you been? You're a Vogue International currently.
International Vogue.
International Vogue.
I won in Virginia.
Dominion?
No. Oh.
We sorry. We probably should have had a list.
Ray Hall was the owner. They don't.
National Icon.
Yes.
You won the National Icon.
Kelly and I.
Mm-hmm.
Kelly and I were National Icon.
That's what that crown is for. I thought, because I have another picture, which I'll post right here.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that picture was for Black America, but this picture is for actually you and Kelly being National Icon.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So and I won that. What else? Miss Jacksonville. I won. Oh my! If you can remember all of them, then.
Well, I named the most.
Yeah,
essential.
I named them.
Those, so
and I've been first runner up at a lot of other stuff.
Yeah, everything probably other than US of A.
I always wanted to be Miss K US of A. Always, always, always.
And I wanted to say that because I know you're retiring,
mm-hmm.
but if or and when you decide, maybe, possibly, I'll be excited to see you do that and be
I always said this. I always put high expectations on myself, and when or goals, I set high goals for myself, and I try to accomplish them. I always said if I had ever done USA, I was going to go one time and one time only, and I was going to walk away with that crown that night mm-hmm. because I was inspired by people like Alexis Gabrielle Sherrington and Raquel Lord, individuals that went in and did the pageant one time and walked away with it. You know, that's inspiring.
Yeah,
there were some other girls, Asia O'Hara, I believe.
She won a couple times.
Asia O'Hara did the pageant a couple times?
Yeah, she did a couple. She won a couple times. Ain't but a handful of them that went in and got it.
What about, I know there's a lot of them that did it one time because mm-hmm. USA was always known for being that pageant where it's like, okay, it don't matter who you are, if this girl come right and she right after
right.
that.
So after that, now we are the reigning Miss International Thailand.
Miss
International Queen, excuse me. I just like saying Thailand because it's far.
It is.
Shit,
far.
You got to travel God, 2 far. Days to get there.
It's far.
That's not around the corner. You can't get on the mega bus to go there.
No, it's so far.
Yeah. But once you get there, it's like, mm-hmm. I'm sure it's like worth the experience.
Yeah.
So what, I'm going to say for me, the one of the reasons why I wanted to do this interview was because I felt like you have not gotten the respect and recognition that you deserve. Especially with trans women being on the plateau that they are right now with the title that you've captured, because if it had been anybody else from the States that had won, somebody would have took the initiative to put them on that platform and, you know, make sure that they were visible and in certain places. And I don't have much of a platform at all, but if this interview would do anything, mm-hmm. then great, because I believe you and I want to see you be that. And with you winning such a prestigious title, did you expect the love that you got, and then did you expect the negativity that came back?
Because
I've experienced it with Drag Race, you know, you
honestly,
see it, but.
Okay, so let me answer the question. The love that I got, they were giving me that same love before I won over there in Thailand. Like when I stepped off the plane, they treated me just wonderful. Like there were like especially the people that were working for the pageant, they were wonderful to me. And the girls that were competing there were so nice. At first, when we had our first time, when we were all together and we were seeing everybody for the first time, it was a bit different. And it was nerve-wracking because I'm seeing all of these beautiful girls just walking here. I'm like, oh my gosh. And not only that, I'm the only person that looks like me at the time. But they were very nice to me. Now, some contestants did begin to change as the competition went on. And you have to understand, we compete. It's 2 weeks long.
They realized who you were throughout that competition.
Yeah, it was 2 weeks long. And it was like after the, like we do talent, you do talent like a week before finals. So once I did the talent segment and
it changed,
I won.
It changed the game.
I remember getting back on the bus and it was like silence. It was like, and then after that it was like, oh, she's gonna win. That all the girls were like, oh, she's gonna win. You know, and in my mind, I'm thinking, I was thinking, wait, I'm not answering the question. They did show me love. And then when I got the negativity when I won, I didn't even pay that no attention, honestly, like that. Because I was on such a high, and the thing about it is, there was a lot of negativity, but it was blocked by all the love that I got from the U.S.
Like we was on it.
Yeah.
We was cussing people out left and right, baby, reporting you, yeah. All that.
The love that I got from the U.S. overshadowed people in Vietnam, and I've never been to Vietnam or Korea, I've never been there. I could care less. I didn't care. I understand that those countries don't view us as beauties.
Yeah.
You know, and if you're not a size 2, what's crazy is I'm used to being the skinny one.
Mm-hmm.
And even with me being skinny, I was not because I was more curvaceous. But that's why I let that be known when I was being interviewed over there. We're trans and we're all shaped different. My culture, black women are shapely and have breasts and curves. And, you know, that's how some black women are made. Y'all are of Asian descent. Y'all are smaller built, you know. So appreciate my beauty for what you see it as. It's not like I'm looking nasty and nothing like that. But the love was, the love overshadowed the negativity to answer the question.
And at that moment when they called your name as Miss International Queen, I mean, because we were all like watching it live, like just shaking and bitch. I know I would have the jitters. Like, What does that feel like? For me, like I've won a lot of things. But, and I don't take away from anything that I've accomplished, But I haven't genuinely won the things that I wholeheartedly wanted. Mm-hmm. So I don't think I've ever really had that experience yet that was like, oh my God, I actually accomplished something that I set out to do. My drag career, I'm happy with and appreciative of. But a lot of things that have happened in my career have happened sporadic. It wasn't, the major things wasn't things that I planned out. I didn't plan Drag Race. I didn't plan Taylor Swift. I didn't plan Ellen. It just happened.
Yeah.
But the things that I planned out, I haven't achieved them yet. Yeah. So what does that feel like?
It's an out-of-body experience. It really is. And especially when you speak things, when you have been speaking things for years. Everything that I have won, I spoke it. I have been saying that I was going to be Miss Duval since I was 17. I've been saying that I was going to be Miss Continental since I was 17. I've been saying that I was going to be Miss International Queen since probably 2009. You know, when I first started paying attention. Because I started paying attention to the pageant because of Mimi.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like this big thing that they were Miss Continentals, which is the biggest title, you know, over here. And they went over to another country and they won. So it separated them from everybody else. Yeah, they're Miss Continentals, but they went to Thailand and they won Miss International Queen. And so I set the bar high for myself. And so I said, I'm going to win that pageant. And I had been saying that for years and years and years that I was going to win Miss International Queen. And I was very specific with it too. I said, I'm going to be the first black girl to win that pageant. And everything that I said, even with Miss Continental, even the year that I won, I would tell people, I'm winning this year. And you know, some people, you hear a lot of people just say that. But I knew that what I was going to present, and not just your package on the stage. I just felt that the stars had aligned for me. And once I channeled in.
Was that your same feeling at Miss Continental? Was that your same feeling at Miss Duval? Like those nights? Like it felt like it was yours?
Duval, no. No. I knew with Continental, I was like, this is my year. I'm going to win this year. With International Queen. With International Queen, I said, I'm going to win it. But did I feel like they were going to crown me? I did not know. Did I know that I had the capability to win and beat the girls that were there? Yes, I did feel that. But that's why I was very vocal. Anytime the microphone hit my hand,
you had to.
I called it out, you know, and that's what you have to do. It's like, look, I've been watching this pageant for years, and I have seen so many contestants come here that look like me get so close. You know, I had seen so many contestants, black girls,
Silky,
get first.
Stasha,
but you know, Stasha,
just to name a few.
Yeah, Stasha was the first one to make the top three. She got second runner up, and Chantel got first runner up. And then there was a girl from Brazil that got first runner up. There was a girl from, I think, Germany, black girl that got first runner up. So you had a lot of first runner ups, and I'm like, the theme of this pageant is world equality. So if this is going to be world equality, if you're going to say this is world equality, we need representation. We need representation of everybody. And when I look up here at these formers, these pictures of these formers, I don't see nobody that even remotely or closely looks like me at all. Not even.
And you're not going to tell me that ain't one black girl and came through here.
You know,
and shook it up enough
to win. But like I said, also too, I did my homework and I studied. And I noticed how some contestants could have given them room, because from me studying and from me learning from others' mistakes, I was able to strategically just plan and know everything that I was going to do once I got to the spot that I needed to get, which was the top six. I knew without a shadow of a doubt, once you got to that top six, you had to answer the question. Once you get to the top three, you have to answer the question. And what you have, I knew in my situation, being that it's broadcasted very largely over there and it's broadcasted everywhere, but it's on live, I knew that I had to make it
work.
I had to make it known to the world that I won. And I knew the only way to do that was to murder the questions. That was the only way that I was going to be able to, they were going to say, we cannot take this.
So here we go, Miss USA. Here's your question. What is the theme of this contest and how do you feel about it?
Thank you. The theme is world equality. We all need to be equal. We're born with that right. Everyone is equal, regardless of your color of your skin, regardless of the person that you choose to love, regardless of the person that you choose to marry, regardless of the God that you choose to worship. We are all equal. And that is why I am here today. I am here today to show the world for the first time that we're all equal and that someone that looks like me can be the winner as well.
Like I was
Thank
the most
you.
Beautiful in the pageant. I wasn't the most beautiful. My first one up, I mean, she was gorgeous. You know, that's my daughter. Shout out to Asmin. Hey, daughter.
Yeah, we got a picture of her right there.
Yes, that's Asmin. That's my daughter.
And shaped out of butter.
Yes, she is a sweetheart. She started to call me mommy. You know, she said, you say you cool. No, she said, cool ma. I said, what's cool ma? She said, I'm baby, you mommy. And that's how our relationship started. But I didn't let the relationship blossom until after I won.
because we don't want no shit.
Because I knew she was my competition. Yeah. I knew she was my competition. And we were rehearsing one day and I said, they trained you, didn't they? And she said, yes. That's how she talked. She don't talk a lot of English. She said, yes, mommy. Yes. She was a beast. She was a beast. Sure. And we were right behind each other. And so when we rehearsed, like I said, for 2 weeks. Oh, it's a lizard up there. We rehearsed for like 2 weeks. And I was always able to go behind her. So I was always able to observe. And that's how I knew she had been trained. Like, so I had to adapt their way of pageantry because they don't like all of the,
right.
I would have never won. Had the pageant been, you come in, you fly in, you do the pageant, I would not be Miss International Queen. Absolutely not.
Just because your upbringing in pageantry, being normal, Giselle.
Not what they like.
Right.
Not whatsoever. They do not, all the things that take us up over here and up, it's, they want Miss USA, Miss Universe.
Queen, what would you tell 13-year-old Giselle today for the future?
I would tell 13-year-old Giselle, start taking hormones right now. Right now. Inject yourself, overdose, bitch, right now. That's the honest guy truth. I really would. I would tell my 13-year-old self, start hormones. It's okay. Because I had dysphoria growing up. But like growing up in a Black Christian household, you don't, that type of education and terminology is not available. But I knew that I had gender dysphoria without a doubt. And yeah, I would tell Giselle, go out and
just start now.
Start now. If you, I wish that I had that information when I was 13 to start. I would also tell. My goodness, that's a deep question.
Yeah,
that's a
deep. I know, because it's so much. Like if I would tell myself. That if you possess the talent that you have today, then you could honestly wait to be Trinity. It's not a necessity for you to do it right now because then I would have experienced all the things that a kid would have and went to the schools and the prom, you know, the prom. And that definitely for me would have been something that I would have told myself, like, just, you know, I can't wait.
Yeah, I would tell myself to keep singing.
Basically, you're gonna be okay.
Yeah, basically,
you're gonna be okay.
That's a deep question. People don't think about that, but that's a deep question to go back and tell your 13-year-old self. Now, I could tell my 21-year-old self, don't date him. You know, run away from him. Don't trust this one. Absolutely, I could tell my 21 and 25-year-old self, my 30-year-old self, I could go back and tell them, but my 13-year-old self, that's when I was innocent. You know, that makes me, you know, actually emotional, you know, thinking about me at 13, at 12, like, I wish that the 32-year-old Giselle could go back in time and know what I know now and go inside that 13-year-old Giselle but the difference is, that one got me because my mind just thinking. I probably wouldn't even, you probably wouldn't even be sitting here in front of me to tell you the truth.
Yeah.
If I could have got to that 13-year-old, I probably would I probably would be post-op, and I would have been in the entertainment field some kind of way, but I wouldn't have been a showgirl. I wouldn't have been like a drag show pageant girl. Mm-mm. I would have never dated gay men. None of that. I would have never did any of that if I could have got to myself at 13. But the 16-year-old Giselle, she experienced a lot and she came across a lot of people. And you know, it changed a lot.
Well, she did good work. You did good work. So okay, so real quick, so where do you see Giselle now in 5 years? What do you want to be in 5 years? Mm-hmm. 30 seconds. Tell me where we're going to be.
I want to have lots of money in the bank. I want to invest in a business. I would love to have a Grammy. I would love to win a Grammy. I want to win a Grammy. I want to do music. I want to have a big hit. And that one, be able to eat off that one song for the rest of my life, like All I Want for Christmas.
Thank God.
I want one of those kind of Mariah Carey hits. And I want to be in a relationship, be married, be content, be happy. I want to be able to be a homeowner and all those type of things. No.
Well, you're going
to and have a child, hopefully. You know, I kind of gave up on that part, but hopefully, I don't know, you know, I may be able to do in vitro, you know, and have a child.
Well, you have managed to manifest and speak all of the things that you want in your life to happen. Clearly, you've said you wanted to do these things and it happened for you.
Yeah.
And if you continue having that, you know, that passion and that drive, like, you're going to get all of the things that you deserve to have. And I definitely see you having all of those things. And I love you, and I appreciate you, and I am so, like, happy that you allowed us to sit here and do this.
Yeah,
Barbie.
Yeah. I feel like we were very rushed. There was a situation that happened that was under my control, and we didn't get to get into, like, the other part of Giselle. I wish I would have said that about Giselle Harvey. You know, Giselle Harvey is, I am a Bliss employee, which is a HIV STD clinic. I do HIV testing. I get people into treatment every day. And so I'm always out there to help people. And a lot of times when people are screaming for help, people reach out to me and say, hey, this person needs help or something like that. And earlier I was in a situation where someone was, you know, talking about harming themselves and they were in a whole other state. And I took the initiative to make sure that person was okay. So that really ate up an hour of the time we could have had to talk.
Hey, I'm appreciative. Yeah. I'm sure they are. We are definitely happy to have you here.
And that person is okay.
And they are okay, yes. Yeah. So everything is good. But thank you for sitting down with me. Thank you for allowing me to have this. This is my first sit down, Barbara Walters special. Yeah. And it means a lot to me, and it'll be the first of many.
And congratulations on winning talent at Miss Continental.
I won talent at Miss Continental, and I'm so happy.
And I watched it. I got a chance to watch your talent, and it was amazing. It was amazing. And you know, I told you this before. You know, you are one of the most talented individuals that we have in our industry.
Thank you.
You know, you really are, and I don't say that, and I don't have no reason to lie. You know, you truly are.
Thank you.
And you have a long future ahead of you. You just gotta just stay in the game. Everybody's story not the same. Some get it fast and some get it, but some get it, it take a little longer. But the one thing I learned is you get it when you're supposed to get it.
Yep. Your main season.
It happens when it was supposed to happen, because let me tell you, the 21-year-old Giselle, baby, I was bitter when I didn't win Miss Duval my first year, because you couldn't tell me that I didn't win Miss Duval, and I still stand by it. Love my auntie to death. I still stand by it. I won Miss Duval that first time. But guess what? I didn't win it, and she was supposed to win that night. And I didn't win it the year after that. I didn't win it the year after that, and I didn't win it the year after that. But I went every single year. I never took a year off. I went every year until I won. And when I finally won, I won every category. So it's kind of like a story. I know people always be cliche and say, oh, never give up or stuff like that. But no, truly, if it's something that you want and you say you're going to be, you know, you can't give up on it. You're going to get frustrated. I had my times when I said, oh, I ain't going back to this. But it was truly what I wanted.
Thank you for coming. Thank you for sitting down with us. Thank you guys for tuning in to this interview. If you can, please make sure that you share. Follow Jazelle Barbie Royale on all her social media. We'll have it at the end of this video. Support the entertainment industry. Support the trans community. Trans Lives Matter.
That's a topic we didn't touch.
Yeah.
See, we could have got on all of that, but our time.
We gonna talk. Look, yeah. We can talk again. It's no tea. We can get together again. Yeah. This ain't our last interview. But thank you all for tuning in. Please tune into my next interview and to my videos, everything. Follow me on my social media. And we love you. Signing off.
Bye.
This is TKB TV. Bye.
Kapunka.
Kapunka. Did I say that right?
Yeah, Kapunka.
That was so cute. Bye, y'all. Pussy and mimosas. We ain't finished, tell him beat it up. Beat it and up. If the pussy stop breathing, give it CPR. It's so fat, he think he sipped in my butt. I don't swallow plan B, I just swallow the nuts. Pussy dope, I'm the dope dealer. And if your pussy good, shouldn't have to maintain a broke nigga. Dope nigga. Real shit, real life, everybody game.